Last session is from Christian Hanke, who is their partner at Edenspiekermann. Now, Christian has been working with The Economist, Neue Zürcher Zeitung, and Zeit Online, and looking at design thinking for editors and product teams. So he's here to share his experiences of what to do and what not to do. The floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for coming here for the last session of this year's conference. So I'm glad that you're all still here with me. So yeah, as he said, I'm Christian Hanke. I'm one of the partners. This is what we do at Edenspiekermann. Oh, there's a problem with the signal. So around 110 people from 19 nationalities, 5 locations, and those are some of the newsrooms which we work for, and which I'm glad to share some of the learnings and some of the experiences we gathered over the last years on working with newsrooms, working with product teams on the topic of design thinking. First of all, I would like just to get an overview of you guys. Has anybody of you worked with the method of design thinking so far? Okay, at least there are some. That is great to hear. Thanks for joining us. So I will structure it like that. I will talk a little bit in the beginning about what it is, then talk a little bit about what it's good for, and then we'll share some of the learnings from the last years working in that field and how it is applicable for newsrooms of different sizes. This happened in last October. I was at a workshop in Boston, USA, with a scientific publisher, and we did a session and worked on their digital experience, how scientific publications can be experienced and how the users should be met with their needs. And there was an interesting conversation I just want to share with you, because that's driving you straight to the point of why we're doing design thinking and what is so interesting about it. So I heard this conversation, and one of the participants of the workshop said, like, yeah, I really want to do a big navigation on this scientific publication, and we have so much stuff I want to show to all the users being happily in my experience. And we said, like, well, that's not a user need to have a navigation per se. That's just a feature, you know. A user need would be to I need some orientation, or I need to find around. But the answer was, so can we change the user's needs? And that really brought me to the point where I said, like, nope. This is not how we should build digital products. And this is not how we should think in newsrooms about digital experiences for our users, for our readers, for the audience which we are actually working for and which we're even expecting to pay for. So I think, I hope I can bring you a little bit closer to working for users and for their needs, and what's so important about that for you working in product, working in the news or magazine business. So just quickly, what actually is design thinking? Because a lot of you guys maybe heard about the term. It's been around for some 25 years, and a lot of people think, like, designers are doing stuff like that, just designing beautiful, colorful things. But actually, that's not all we do. When we do design thinking, and when we describe it, I would say it's a method and a way of thinking to develop innovative ideas fast, or solve problems with the human, with a social focus. And the most important thing for me is that there are three components, so to say, which are crucial. First of all, it's human-centered research methods. So what you heard in the beginning about this example of, can we change the user's needs? That's really one part, one big component of doing design thinking or following this method and this way of thinking to really work in user-centered research methods. So to find out from their perspective, from a user's perspective, jump in their moccasins and really understand what are their needs and not what are my strategic goals and how can I pursue them. The second one is iterative development. So this mindset of a product is never finished, but it's actually a learning curve, and I build on each of the things I've learned of the insights, and so I build something, I test it, I learn something, then I do something different, and this is something of an iterative development. And the third thing is creativity, design, and visualization. There's a power to a visualization and to bringing ideas out, speaking them out, visualizing them, and this is so important to design thinking, because a lot of the times you may have experienced yourself with your colleagues in a room and just talking and talking, but there was no result. And the method of design thinking really is about making the results fast, visible and tangible, and being able to use them to gather feedback from our users, right? So, and when we follow our steps, there are tons of methods and models out there, double diamonds, triple diamonds, whatever. But we just follow always two important rhythms. It's always discovering something, condensing something. So we emphasize user needs, then we define the problem we actually have to solve. Because if you ask someone, hey, do you want something like this, or what is your problem, they might not say at the first what they are actually needing. So this is very important. Second thing is then to ideate multiple concepts very fast and then condense to one prototype and solution. And then the third one is testing with users, gathering insights, and then iterating on the solution. So it's always discovering and then condensing. So where can you use that? One example is from a totally different industry, not actually from the news industry or the journalism industry necessarily, but we worked with Netherlands' biggest railway company, and in the Netherlands there is a problem because it's a different company which runs the trains, which runs the platforms, and which is responsible for the station. So those are different companies, and they don't talk that much to each other. So when we were asked to help them, it was about one of the biggest railway hubs in the Netherlands, and they were constructing over a period of 10 years and building new platforms and building new parts of that. And there was a huge chaos for passengers to find the right track, because they would change every week. And there was a safety issue with getting too close to the train, actually. So what we did there was, with the method of design thinking, we invited passengers as well as engineers, as well as designers, as well as different stakeholders who would work there and ideate with them together how we can solve this problem. So we were starting with observations, like following passengers throughout the day for some weeks and finding out how they would interact on the platform, what are the problems they currently occur, to find out what the actual problem was, and so on. And then together with this bunch of people, we ideated and developed a lot of ideas and concepts, which we then tested. And the most successful was actually a collaboration between an engineer, a designer, and a passenger, because the passenger said, like, one of my biggest problems is I don't know where to stand when the track is very crowded, and I want to stand at platform 9, for example, and the train occurs, and I don't know where the doors are. I don't know which part of the train is already very full. And the engineer said, you know, by the way, we measure where people sit, because we have to we have to testify how much people are using the trains to get our money for the usage of the tracks and stuff. And so they came up with this idea that they would show at which part the train, quickly before the train arrives, they show where the doors, they show which part of the train is there. And I don't know if you've been on a train in Germany, but in Germany there's one location at this platform where you can look up where the train wagons are. And so everybody runs there and then knows, 27 is in B, and then they run across the whole platform and that creates a chaos. And sometimes they switch it. That's a specialty of the German railway. And so what they did here is a 160 meter long LED display. It's the full length of the whole train. And it displays just before the train arrives, where are the doors and where how much people are already sitting in this wagon. And green means that you should board here because there's a lot of space available, and yellow means that it's partly crowded, and red means that it's very crowded. And this helped tremendously to increase the safety on the platform, but also helped to board faster, which increases the accuracy and of the trains, and helped in many different ways. And this would not have been possible if only engineers, or if only passengers, or if only designers would have worked on a solution, right? So it's really about that. And the highlight was that the Queen was actually being presented. And this is the Queen, and this is us. And it was amazing. My colleagues were totally thrilled, and the Queen is just blow away everybody in this room. And she liked our solution, actually, so which is the biggest honor. We got some prizes. The second one is maybe closer to your home, because the second case I just quickly present is was a challenge we faced when we relaunched Zeit Online. Zeit Online is one of the largest news sites in Germany. It's around 10 million unique users a month. It's one of the youngest audiences. Over 34% are below the age of 29. And so the challenge there was coming from user interviews we did before we did start the relaunch, and talk to them how they would digest news and all of that. They said, how can I digest your stories better on my smartphone? You know, I like your stories. I like reading the news on your website, and your staff is doing a great job. But what I did what I do with all the other apps on my smartphone is like this. And then they started doing this gesture. And we thought, like, okay, maybe we have to take that serious and have to think about how we can come up with with a better way to tell stories for specific smartphone audience. And I mean, it's maybe a common thread, because all of you guys experience the same thing. A mobile audience is above 50% now, and so we really have to take that serious. So we brought together 23 people from print, from online, from social media, so journalists, editors, developers, publishing managers, and designers to invent new mobile storytelling formats. And that was really eye-opening, because a lot of the times this is the first time that those people come together in one room before something starts, not after something is done and they want to argue about it. So this was really interesting, and especially, I think he's sitting here, head of advertising there. He was saying, like, I hate workshops. I think this is always the best start for a workshop like that. But after that, he was really amazed, and it was really great. We developed a method, especially for them. It was a 3-hour method. It was a game. We draw that from this whole methodology of serious gaming, where you play games to find out solutions faster. And together we developed very fast tangible ideas of mobile storytelling formats. And out of those, they were then structured and then challenged. So first you ideate a lot. So every group had 8 formats, and then we broke them down into 2. And then those 2 were prototyped, and then they were challenged about which is the first thing then to start if we want to build them, what is the highest potential in advertising, who would be involved, how much time in production, and so on. So it's not only about creating interesting ideas, but it's also about bringing them into life after selecting the right ones and building prototypes early. So this is how it looked then. And so those were the different formats, which were not only here, but you can also see the personas they were targeting, and then defining the use case. How much time would that be? What would be really the benefit compared to a classic article? What do we need in resources? Where should we start with? And some of the ideas were really raw in the beginning. And that's totally okay, especially for people who are not familiar with expressing their ideas in a visual way. It's very important to encourage them. And I think you heard, maybe some of you heard the talk before, but it's a lot about encouraging the newsroom on spitting out their ideas and being able to visualize them. This was the start. And after that, we then followed that in a structured way. So one of the most promising prototypes was a card-based storytelling format, and then we explored it into what kind of storytelling mechanism could we abstract out of that? Could we sort into something of a template? We had then different versions of it. So this was the very first sketch. We then thought about the concept further, developed it further. What are the techniques? What are the mechanics there? Then we built one of the first a little bit more elaborate prototypes, which totally failed. To the first user group, because it was too squarish and too colorful, it looked like an ad, because it was the shape of a medium rectangle banner ad, and so we had to change all of that, and then we tried different versions of card types, image text, to parallel stories to tell, or different options to do non-linear storytelling. And this was then the first working prototype where we had gathered a lot of feedback already before. And I forgot to translate that. So the early worm catches the feedback. So the earlier you get the feedback, the cheaper it is, because you did not build so much stuff already. And so that is quite important. And this is... Those are then different iterations we did on them, how to present different types of text. And for me, it's always very important, the closer we get to something of a result, the more important it is to have real copy, real text in those applications. It does not make sense to do any prototyping with lorem ipsum or anything like that. So this is why we call it editorial prototyping. So it's really important to have the editors in there and to figure out, because a new format also means something of a new writing style. And when we then launched this storytelling format and side editors worked with it, the best feedback I got was 2 things. First, they said we now added a new sound to our storytelling, which was great. And the second one was, damn, I have to be so precise on those small cards in my storytelling, and it takes me more work to be more precise. but users love it. This is the final thing. It's kind of a stack of cards where you can tell a story, and this stack of cards can be implemented all over the site. And this was one of the big things in there. Maybe some of you guys know the outline from Josh Topolsky. Actually, they copied my cards. No, it's an obvious UX metaphor, but but this is where we started there. And the editorial team of Zeit Online are 60 people working online only. They created about 500 stacks now with more than 3,000 cards in it. And what we see there is that users really love it. User feedback was quite high in terms of if they go over the second card, they almost stay the whole thing. And we, of course, optimized also the ways we talk there, and really gave them a new way of storytelling. And that was interesting. It just came out of this one workshop and gave them a totally new way of telling stories. Yeah. So why do we need design thinking in the newsroom? I just have to say one thing before. Journalists and designers, we have something in common, you know? Relationships are key. So for us, it's really about building relationships, especially in digital audiences, with our readers and the journalists, to really help them build something of a relationship. Because time is over that we think of users as those idiots there in the comment section. We really have to take them serious and think about their context and their situation in which they are consuming our content, right? So what we do have in common is that just decorating is not enough for designers. And just telling a story is not enough for journalists, you know. So that is a big thing we have in common, and which we have to solve together. So our shared goal should be to develop intelligent tools for rich storytelling based on the knowledge of context and usage. So really thinking about the context and usage of our users and their needs to do better storytelling and to build better tools to do storytelling, right? And so it can help teams and individuals to establish a user-centric mindset. Think about the first example I told you guys with, can we change the user need? No, we cannot. And this thinking of, okay, from a user's perspective, my story should maybe cover also that. Or if I do a investigative piece on people in prison, maybe I think about their families, and maybe they have different languages I have to cover, or I so this whole user-centered thing can also really help journalists to do better storytelling, to think about their audience in a different way than just okay, they could be happy that they are cherished with this great piece of content I write for them. You know, really thinking about their content, about their context, and if in the morning they have a different need and need something else. It can also help to find new product and story ideas in a very efficient way. So it really creates efficiency in the product development. And as one component of a larger cultural transformation, I'm not saying design thinking will change a whole organization. That is far too big, but it can be a very nice component of a larger cultural transformation to bring a legacy media, for example, organization into a user-centered mindset of digital product development. So this is really something which we have seen and have learned so far. So if I think about what we learned so far with the organizations we worked for, I have eight things to say. First, editors love to speak to users and distill insights themselves. They really do. It's a myth that editors are not interested in their readers. I see that sometimes as a prejudice, and they say like, yeah, why shouldn't we do that and blah, blah, blah. But the first moment they are facing a user and actually talking to them, I would say 90% of them would really love to get their own insights, and they would be thrilled about it. And when I do workshops in newsrooms or with J schools or all of that, most of the time they say like, wow, I haven't been speaking to users for more than a year, and this week we already spoke twice to them. And, you know, they just see them as sources for investigative pieces. But really talking to them and getting a little bit about the context, and sometimes it's really, which is the second part, lean and small research and testing rounds are the most powerful. You don't have to set up a testing round with 1,000 people or whatever, but do it quick and do it fast and do it often. Like what we discover is sometimes it's really helpful if you have 6-7 people who show up every 2 weeks, so that you establish yourself something of a culture or a pressure to really test something every 2 weeks, which is sometimes very, very helpful. And I bet there would always be something to test. Then doing fancy workshops is or using colorful post-its is not a strategy. I can't say that loud enough. Because what you did not see on the workshop I described in the beginning was that this was part of a larger process. And I now have to talk about Maslow. Because if you think about Maslow and his hierarchy of needs, everybody knows it, right? Eat, drink, sleep, then safety needs, social needs, esteem needs, and self-actualization. So until here, it's about deficiency, and from here on, it's growth. And if you transfer that to working in a self-organized or interdisciplinary work culture, it actually starts over here. So you have to create in your organization, or you have to fulfill all of those before you get there. So before people in your organization will start doing design thinking on their own, not in a workshop you are conducting, they need a lot of things to know first. They need to know, I know my job is safe. I'm equipped with all the tools and help I need to fulfill my job. I know where I belong to. I have the confidence that positive change will happen here with us. That is so important. I can't stress out that enough. Because a lot of the times, the biggest challenge for a process of design thinking or innovation in a news organization is it won't change anything anyways. You know, and if you have this culture and this bias in your organization, there won't be happening anything, of course. So I know where I want to go and what my part in this is. I know the expectations towards my role and my scope of autonomy. We experience this a lot that when news orgs are changing to digital, there are new roles like a product owner or a product manager, not a project manager. That is something totally different. And then people say like we need entrepreneurial journalists and whatever that means. And so there's a lot of expectations, but if we don't put that expectations to the table and say like, okay, this is also the amount of autonomy you have to fulfill that, and this is the clear expectation towards your role, that's what we mean if we say product development. That's very important. And then of course there is something of, I feel competent and enabled for my role and tasks, and my colleagues reassure me about that. This is also important, because a lot of the times then people feel like, you know, they don't trust me anyways, and they always invite designers at the last point and all of that. I see a value for me personally to collaborate with other disciplines in a new way. It's astonishing to see sometimes that journalists never worked with product managers or with user testers or with designers directly. And when their first experiences, they see like, wow, there's a value in me to work with them together, to share my knowledge and all of that. And then I want new ways, and then I'm able and want to develop new things regularly. So there's a lot of things which we have to establish in our organizations before we can expect innovation to just happen, you know? Fourth thing is offer a custom toolbox of small and large methods based on the needs of your organization. So when we work with organizations, we not just only do one workshop and then we're out, because this is the whole thing about having a fancy workshop and all of that. But what we rather do is saying like, okay, what are the learning goals? So we spend 1 week with them, see how they work, see how they do in product development, how their workflows are, how close the editorial team is to the product team, how close editorial team is working already with users or not and all of that. And then we can see what they should learn, and then we give them a toolbox. For example, with one team, we gave them a toolbox to do design sprints, like 5-day design sprints on actual product developments, and we broke down the different methods and gave them little custom cards on the methods that they can spread to do those methods also separately, because this might be only a 15 minutes method which they can use in their daily lives, because not all of them have have always 5 days a week time, right? So having different methods and different tools to use in different situations of the process is super important. Short ones of 10 minutes, long ones. Number five is, if you do not have to have the culture or the courage or the time to act on your workshop results, do not even start. That is so important, because nothing is more frustrating, and I experienced it firsthand, that you do a great workshop and at the end of the day they say, and now? What's happening next? And then you say like, well, I have to say that I'm not sure how this will work out, because I did not get a clear signal that this will work on and stuff like that. So what we tried to do and what we did, for example, here was that the teams worked 5 days, and then they presented to the whole management team of that news organization. They pitched it, and they had a method with a very structured pitch thing, and they had a already tested prototype, and they presented directly to the management team. And then the management team had to decide how to go further, and had to commit on what to do next. And they had a very structured feedback around also, so that nobody talks too much, which is a great strength of management team. And that was really a way to close the gap between having a workshop result and bringing it to action. And that was really great, because it created a lot of esteem and reassurance for those colleagues that they can build something within a week, and can do user research at the beginning of the week, and can do user testing at the end of the week, and can have a solid tested prototype and present it to their bosses. And sometimes it was the first time of them presenting to their boss directly. And that was so encouraging, and that was so great for them. Front-end developer, designer presenting to the whole management team. And the feedback of the CEO was, I never had a structured pitch presentation like that in my whole life at this company. So they were really amazed about it. And those are the small things which are really important, right? Then mixed teams are not an extra, but a prerequisite. So again, it's not about two editors sitting together and having great ideas, but it's really about mixing the team and bring roles in which have a competence and gather how they perform together. For example, this was a Scrum Master we had in this workshop, and some of his ideas were really crucial to the product we then prototyped. This is again where we say like, okay, in the first week we just observe and see what are the big clusters we see there. Learning number seven, be clear about the deliverables and workflows to not leave too many loose ends. Especially in a relaunch process or in a process of developing a product, it's super important to clear up where do all those ideas go to, and how do we put them into something of a clear process. So what we do is we always set up a discovery stream and a delivery stream. Delivery stream is the big one. The team who really develops the product, really builds the product, and the discovery is kind of a small speedboat, which is always like two or three sprints ahead, thinking or preparing an idea, a concept, validating, prototyping, and then handing over a very clear thing. So in the beginning of the process, we would say like, okay, we work now together for the next 10 months, and this team is prototyping this topic, and the deliverable is a prototype, clear user stories for the backlog, and whatever else is needed to them. So to them it's very clear what they should deliver, and to them it's very clear what to expect, and how the ideas then really come to life in the relaunch process, right? And the last thing is, it is as well about setting rooms, facilities, because they express your culture. the biggest sign I got, and maybe some of you would recognize those persons, is that the editor-in-chief of a German news outlet said, like, you know, for the next 2 weeks, you will get my office for your whole team to work in that all 5 days. So he moved out and he gave his editor-in-chief office to the team to work in that office for 2 weeks. And I think this is such a great signal to the whole team, encouraging them to saying, like, guys, this is important to me, and I want to encourage you, and this is why I give you my office. And then, of course, there was a very interesting introduction, what not to touch and what to touch. But it really meant a lot to those people, and especially to the team members, that they were really encouraged, right? Yeah. And of course, the most important thing for us as an agency is to create a pride-free curiosity, because I think this is the most important trait or most important competence we all have to learn to win the future. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Christian. Does anybody have any burning questions? We are pretty much out of time, but if you do have a question and you're not afraid to ask it, this is your time. Christian is available. His contact details were on the screen. Thank you so much for making DIS 2017 a success. Until next year.
Thank you, guys.